Mr. DeFranceschi, and Mr. Muldari here for the history of pasta and pasta making in Brooklyn.
If you had anything to do with the pasta industry, please just quickly introduce yourself. Let's know who you are and anything you want to say about that, the pasta industry. Starting with Joe.
Joe DeFranceschi. I make pasta machines, formerly here in Brooklyn for 25 years. And
My name is Danny Maldari, family business. Right now, my brother Chris and I, our grandfather started the business with his brother in 1901 in Manhattan and moved to Brooklyn in 1957 in Park Slope, and we're still there today, making dyes for the pasta industry.
What's the name of the business?
D. Maldari and Sons.
Hi, I'm DeFranceschi. My grandfather was one of the first pasta manufacturers in New York, in Brooklyn, New York, many, many, many years ago. G. Santoro and Son.
Tom DeFranceschi. I know pasta machines with Joe Lambert.
A lot of French.
29 years at DEMACO. Great career, a lot of fun.
Leah DeFranceschi, the sister, and a lover of pasta, and a doctor.
I know we have some in the back.
Tom Vermillon with Zarega Pasta. It's a sixth generation family business. Started in 1848 on Front Street in Brooklyn, what is now Dumbo. About 100 years later, in 1950, we moved out to Bergen County, New Jersey, where we are with a factory there, and then another one in Kansas City. We make a couple hundred million pounds of pasta here.
All right. So I hope you heard that we'll cover that a little bit more, and that, certainly the oldest pasta company in the United States. So. Joe?
Hey, Joe DeFranceschi, his cousin. Our grandfather and great-grandfather started the machine business in the U.S. Quite some time ago on Morgan Avenue in Brooklyn.
Okay, anybody else? Yeah.
Steve Gonzalez and Scott Ketchum of Spalletti Pasta. We manufacture all organic pasta here in Brooklyn, 4 years old.
Yeah. Steve?
I'm Steve Cullen. I was a token Jew at this company. Joe hired me, and I was the head of R&D, and I was the inventor of the component in a vibratory conveyor called the regulator, and also the component called Fred.
Okay, and again, I'm Len DeFranceschi. I work for DEMACO. I'm also Colonel of the Marines. I have Marines right here in Floyd Bennett Field. I'm a reserve Marine. So good to be here, as I said. Now, this is kind of a little bit of a lie here because it's not just the history of pasta in Brooklyn. I was going to set the stage a little bit by talking about, you know, the history of pasta in general in the United States. And of course, there's always that legend out there about Marco Polo being the one to introduce pasta to the Italians. And, you know, more than likely, doing the research, it's really every culture probably started a form of pasta one way or another because it's just such a basic, simple food to make. But we're going to talk a little bit more about Marco Polo in a second. But what's very interesting is, believe it or not, one of our founding fathers had an instrumental role in bringing pasta to the United States. And we'll see that in just a second. Here's Marco Polo, and that's his book. And basically what happened with that really is that Marco Polo did the travels and he had an author, De Pasio, write the book based on his journals. And what happened was this book at the time was read throughout Italy, kind of like a sitcom of the day, because if you ever read this book, these exploits of him going into all these places, these exotic places, and a lot of the information there is, you know, really dramatized. It was in the piazzas in the different towns, this became very popular. So what he really did is he popularized pasta in many respects throughout Italy, but he's not the one who actually, there actually is evidence that Italy had pasta before Marco Polo came back and wrote this book, but he did have a role in propagating it throughout all of Italy. Of course, this was found in a tomb in Egypt. So as you can see, you know, way, way back, they're making some forms of pasta. And this, now, I kind of jump around a little bit. There's a reason for some of this. But I just want to show you, this is a little bit about actually some of the technology of making pasta. As pasta started to use equipment to make it instead of just being a more of a handmade process. So if you look at this, and I love this picture. I mean, these guys are just having a great time. They're in their underwear, bare feet. But there's three parts to the process and when they're making it in this day. You have the mix, the gentleman over here, he's mixing the pasta, he's using his feet to do it. Of course, I'm sure that's brought that over from the wine industry. And then you have a bunch of fellows who are bouncing up and down on a stick. You got three of them right here. That is the actual kneading process. That's what they're doing there. And then you have the three fellows here pushing this screw here to actually press the pasta. So it's three different processes to make pasta, as shown here. And then it was brought out onto the street, and you have a pastaio. This gentleman right here, the pastaio is a master pasta maker. He would make sure it dries, keep the dogs and the flies off the pasta, but it would dry on sticks. Okay, so there is a practical reason why pasta is, well, at least spaghetti, which is of course the number one shape of pasta, is long in the way it is, because it was actually part of the manufacturing process where it would dry on sticks. But Naples, it was big in Naples, and a lot of people would travel to Naples on tours, and they would see, this was actually a picture taken from a ship. So, you know, it was interesting to travelers as they would go to places like Naples, and they would see this being sold on the streets. So it had a role in exposing a lot of people to pasta. Now, Naples, you know, climatic conditions, they say because of that, some of the best pasta is from that area. But as you can see, not only drying pasta on the stick was practical for, you know, the shape being long to dry it on a stick, also is basically in many respects a low income food. So people would just eat it without utensils. They just grab it and pick it up and eat it just like that. And a lot of street vendors, as you can see on the right, would sell it right on the street. This is kind of like the olden day McDonald's right here. You'd go there and you'd get yourself a bowl of pasta. Some interesting facts about there's a role in the American Revolution, actually. You probably heard the song, Yankee Doodle Dandy, okay? And macaroni, the term macaroni, in England meant a person of high fashion, as you can see by this dapper-looking fellow here. And, you know, it was a term that defined this kind of cult of people called macaronis. And so the story of Yankee Doodle Dandy was that they were basically, the English were poking fun at the colonials and saying, you guys are just a bunch of rubes. You know, you think you can just put a feather in your cap and call yourself a macaroni. So they were actually taunting the colonials. Well, the colonials actually turned it on the British and say, okay, you guys think you're so much better than us. We're going to use that as part of our war song. It was kind of catchy, but still, it was used as saying, hey, you're just looking down on us, see? You're even saying these kind of things. So it actually became kind of spread through our war song. Okay, so Archimedes has a role, actually. I'll explain that in a second, the Archimedes screw. And by the way, you guys, you heard a lot of people in the industry. You have a lot of knowledge, especially in Brooklyn. So you guys are my fact checkers here. You're my fact checkers. If I say anything wrong, let me know. So you can correct me. But Archimedes, so here is the as I mentioned earlier, this is Thomas Jefferson. He was of course a statesman in one of his many roles. Became a statesman in Paris, an ambassador to Paris. He came there and he was exposed to pasta and pasta making. So he saw this machine. So he came back to the United States, and this is actually in the National Archives, his description of a pasta machine. And I think this is a Maldari. Is this a Maldari die? It's got to be. Okay. So, but the Archimedes screw is the screw that profile is the screw that actually was the same that Thomas Jefferson kind of designed. Okay. So this is a machine from DEMACO, or when we were called ID Franchisee. So we'll talk about that in a second. But I wanted to show. This is like that press that you saw with, you know, a little bit more modernized version of that press that you saw in that other picture. But as you can see, it's similar to the one that Thomas Jefferson basically brought back, but just much bigger. It's a giant mechanical Archimedes-like screw that actually would push the pasta down this, ram it down this cylinder here. And on the bottom, there would be a die. And it would push the form the pasta that way. Now this was actually mechanical, so the next step was hydraulic. But there's two cylinders here, so you're loading one, making pasta on the other, and then you switch back and forth. And we'll see this again in a second. But this is still a batch process. And then you had this matching set, like you saw in the other picture earlier. You got the mixer. And then the grommel, which is the kneading machine, so you'd have all three. Those three machines you just saw were one of the press is the first press that DEMACO ever made, and that went to La Rosa Pasta, which was a big brand here in New York. You may have had a lot of it growing up. Those three machines are all in New York State Museum. If you're ever in Albany, these machines are there. This is just to show what a modern day extruder looks like. So this combines all three, and now it's no longer batch, it's continuous, but this combines all those operations into one machine. So you can see what they look like today. This machine is in use right now, but you've got the kneader inside of this unit here, which is actually, there's a giant screw inside there, which you can't see, an auger screw. You've got a mixer who mixes ingredients, and so it's all into one machine, and think about the old machines you had. You make a discrete amount of pasta. You had the pastaia would grab that pasta, you know, that mixed dough, and you'd grab it and pick it up there and move it over, and you dump it in the kneading machine, and it would turn around, knead it, and then you take it up and put it in the press. And so it was a discrete amount. This just, flour just comes in and pasta just comes out. Okay, so now that's a little bit about the technology and a little bit about the history all the way up till the point where now we're going to talk specifically about pasta here in Brooklyn. Okay, so obviously many Italians came through Ellis Island, and 4 million between 1880 and 1924. And of course, as you know, many took up homes right here in Brooklyn. And so at the time, pasta was really sold in bins. And so it's dry goods stores, and you have you go to a place like this if you want to get some pasta, and you would they would shovel it out of bins like you see on the side here, sold in loose quantities, and measured up, and there you get your pasta, and so oftentimes it was sold, you know, it was delivered to you in a horse and carriage. And so we'll talk about one of the first guys who was doing all this, and that was this is getting cut off a little bit. Sorry about that. I don't know why that is, but this is Arriga. You met, is it three greats? Did I get that right?
Yeah,
great, three greats in there. So that's him. This is the first pasta company in the United States. It was located, it's hard to see on the map, but it's right here by, as mentioned earlier. He was a very popular man, and Zariga Avenue is named after him. Okay, so their brand, the Glutaroni. Of course, there's a trade show booth. Love those salesmen. Got the haberdashery, can't be beat. And of course, the product here, and I love this, you know, kind of get an idea of how the stuff was advertised in the day. But, you know, they even got the dog salivating. He likes it so much. So reminds me of my own dog. But anyway, so what happened was, due to the ban on imports from Europe during World War I, the companies had to start making pasta. Instead of buying it from Italy and importing it, they had to start making it in Brooklyn itself. So that's when the pasta machinery manufacturers started to come on the scene, like my grandfather's company, which started making pasta machines in 1914. So right around the time of World War I, when just before, you know, there started to get bans in Europe on bringing in pasta. But it was still really considered an ethnic food. It was mostly Italians who ate pasta at the time. The way most of the companies set up is really they're very the manufacturing companies, the actual companies that made the machinery, really were very closely located to the actual manufacturers. So for example, my grandfather's company on Morgan Avenue was only a few blocks away from one of the actual manufacturing companies, Metropolitan Macaroni. And what's key to it too is Brooklyn is had a lot of foundries. This is the place where the foundries are. And as you saw from those machines, the early machines, the three that you saw in the batch processing, they're made of casting, so they're very heavy. And they used to have to move this stuff by horse and carriage. And my grandpa used to say, you know, they would move this thing, and if they couldn't get it to the final destination, because it was so big, they would just leave it in the street and come back the next day because, you know, nobody's going to mess with it because it was just too heavy, and they would take the trolley to there. So it was very key that they're near the foundry. So that's part of, and the businesses they support. Going backwards. So this is I, De Francesi and Son. This is my my grandfather, my great grandfather, and they were on Morgan Avenue, and they bought some equipment that was surplus from the Civil War. And the lathe that they had, it was a tiny little place, and the lathe that they had, actually, when they're making some of those big parts, the parts would actually stick out into the road. They were so big. Here's some, just for the company that I work for, so he started making pasta machines in 1914. His first customer was La Rosa. First machine he built was La Rosa, but he actually didn't start in the pasta business. He actually started in making shoes. Buckles for shoes, and then buckled shoes came out of style. So he knew the pasta industry. He couldn't make any money in the fashion industry. Didn't speak the language. Didn't know the people. So he went into the pasta business. And this is a similar story to many of the immigrants that came that are involved with the pasta industry. They spoke the language, they knew the people, they were able to penetrate into that industry. But that's how that happened. And because of, there was another company that was a competitor. So in 1926, it's called Savas, Cavanieri, and Ambretti. They were in Brooklyn, and they merged because of competitive pressure, and they became Consolidated Macaroni Company. And this is actually at Consolidated. They built, and we'll talk about this in a second, the first automatic short good line, and there's a picture of 1936, that was Consolidated Macaroni Company. And that was the merger of those different companies. Again, this is DEMACO. Okay, so Consolidated in 1952 broke up, and out of that breakup, DEMACO was formed, which is the company I work for, and they moved to Metropolitan Avenue. And again, being very close to the machinery manufacturers, being very close to the actual pasta makers was key. If you can see, this is one of the brands from Brooklyn of the day. It was actually right next door, 4645 Metropolitan Avenue, and they were at 4645 Metropolitan Avenue, so literally right next door. He knew this man. They introduced each other. They were from the same industry, so they ended up in the same building, well, right next door neighbors. That's a picture of the company. Probably in the 80s, and you can see the very big machine tools used to make these machines. Now this was a key, this is the automatic spreader. Okay, this is the first one ever made to make a spreader. And so what happened was, this was actually one of the jobs in the plant to make pasta. You'd have a guy, he was called a spreader, and he would cut the pasta with the knife. You can see the knife here. And it was an art. I mean, it was an art. And there was actually used to be fights about how to do this. There was the Neapolitan style of spreading, and there was the Sicilian style, and they'd had literally have fights over this, only like Italians can with the passion they have. And they would take this pasta, slice it, and put it on their arms, and so there was a stick. You saw the stick in the picture earlier, and they would throw it onto the stick, and it would literally fly onto the stick and, you know, perfectly spread out over 36 inches or however long the stick was. And so that job, I mean, these guys were artists, they were tradesmen, like, you know, a Cooper or a Fletcher. And when this machine came out, it really put all these guys out of business. And this was a patent. And what the patent really was all the dies that you saw earlier from those big presses were all round. This one made it long and rectangle. So this is the first long rectangular die ever made. And so that the pasta could be spread or extruded right along the stick and just drop down instead of having to cut it, you know, in a round circle and throw it on the stick. So this allowed, instead of having this guy doing it, allowed for automated pasta. So no more hands-on in the process, no more three machine, you know, this could all be done continuously without touching at all. No hands-on parts of the operation. And because of this, the companies around Brooklyn started buying this, and Brooklyn ended up becoming the spaghetti capital of the world. More spaghetti was made in the Brooklyn area than anywhere else because of this spreader. This is La Rosa. This was at one time the biggest pasta company, at least in New York, maybe possibly in the United States. They were huge. They were originally on Kent Avenue. Found in 1914, same year as our company, because like I said earlier, we made the first extruder or press. But as you can see, there's a series of them, and some gentlemen, you know, working the process, and then the mountain of product before it goes out the door. This is one of the big companies in Brooklyn. And one of the innovations of La Rosa, actually, was they are the first ones who came up with the individual package. So Stefano La Rosa, who was the son of Vincenzo La Rosa, came up with the idea, instead of having them in the bins, I want to do individual one-pound packages that you can buy. And that was his innovation, and it became very popular, and had a big role in of course, in the industry. But as you can see, they would wrap. They liked blue. Packaging was very rare. Packaging, they liked blue. Use blue because it looked good against the pasta for some reason. You'll see a lot of boxes today of pasta. You'll see there's blue, you know, Ronzoni and some of the brands out there. You'll see blue. That's a very popular color in the business. But this is some of the ladies packaging the pasta in individual packages. Now, pasta crossing cultural boundaries. What prompted that? What made it spread? You know, after World War I, you know, they brought in a lot of. It spread, the manufacturing spread because of lack of imports into the United States. But how did it spread basically beyond just being an ethnic food for Italians? Well, it was really two events that converged. One is the Great Depression, because the pasta was very inexpensive. But probably more so than that was the World War II, that a lot of GIs who fought in Europe were exposed to pasta during the war, because it's a good food to use to feed the military. And not only that, but they spent a lot of GIs, American GIs, spent time in Italy. And this article right here, actually from the Brooklyn Eagle, talks about that very fact of the GIs in Europe and the pasta. Okay, so now we're at Maldari. We'll talk about dyes for a second. Do you want to say a few things about that? So just real quick before while he takes the stage here, There's specialists in making machinery, the pasta machinery, but there's also specialists who make the dyes. And the dyes is a very specialized in part of the business. So no machinery maker actually also makes dyes. It's just generally speaking they don't do it because this is an art all into itself. And Chris will tell you a little bit about his company.
So our company that my brother Danny and I own right now is a third generation company. It was started in 1901 by our great uncle. And our grandfather came over a few years later. He was a little bit younger. And he took over, and eventually, in 1925, he bought his brother out. His brother went back to Italy, and he started, it was DEMACO Maltieri. And our father, Ralph, and our uncle, Dan, who was pretty much in the generation with the DEMACO people, they took over in the 40s. What do we do? Well, when people ask me what I do, depending on how much energy I have, sometimes I just tell them something else, but it's not as simple as saying, you know, I'm a lawyer or a doctor or a librarian. We manufacture extrusion dyes for the food industry. So mostly pasta, but also cereal, snack foods. Easiest way I can explain to you what we do is if anybody, when you were a kid, had Play-Doh, and you had the Play-Doh where you put it into a little press, and on the front of it is a rectangular piece, and you slide it in, and you squeeze it down, and it came out whatever shape it was. It's done on small levels, it's done on large levels. So Zurega Pasta is one of our best customers. They make dried pasta. Sfoglini is one of our, do you dry it? I don't even know if you dry it. Do you dry your pasta?
Yeah,
you do.
Yeah.
So anybody knows Pastoza or Queen Anne or anybody in Brooklyn, they make fresh pasta. We make the dyes for all of these things, and after we're finished, we have some dyes over here that you can look at. Basically, everything used to be manual, handmade, and in the 80s, my brother, who's 10 years older than me, he'll say it's hard to believe, but he realized that we needed to automate, so he came up with searching out CNC, computer control machines, to automatically make inserts as opposed to having somebody there machining them, which was much faster and a lot more accurate. And this is pretty much the only job that we've ever had. So the dies that we make go on to the extruders that they make, and when you push the dough through it, it comes out whatever shape, you know, we make. So as an example, specialty shapes, Spider-Man, SpongeBob, macaroni and cheese, right? Or Campbell's soup, the little fancy shapes that you have into the cans.
Sure.
We do all of that stuff. And those kind of shapes, they'll come to us with a drawing. They have to get, obviously, the licensing, you know, from the different companies, Disney or whoever. We'll redesign them because they have to be able to make pasta and not break. And when you cook it, you have to be able to look at it and see exactly what it is. So sometimes it can't look exactly like it does, you know, in a comic book. But that's part of it. Part of it is dry pasta. Part of it is fresh pasta. And we've been doing it a really, really long time. So that's pretty much it.
Now, wait, I got a question.
Mm.
So whenever there's a problem with the pasta, it's always the dye fault, not the extruder fault, right? Isn't that right?
Funny you open that can of worms. So sometimes when they extrude pasta, it doesn't come out evenly, right? It comes out uneven, and that's never the fault of the dye. That's always the fault of the extruder. But fortunately, we can make an equalizer play to let it flow faster where it's coming shorter and let it flow slower where it's coming longer, and then everybody's happy.
I'm happy.
You open that can of worms up. So and that's pretty much it. But afterwards, we have inserts here with pasta, so you can see the insert and what pasta comes out of the insert.
And I think he is the tallest person in the pasta industry. I used to, you know, second might be the second tallest. You got to be the tallest.
Who could be second? No, I guess it's you.
That's okay. And I eat my, yeah, you got to eat it long. You want to get tongue. Okay, good. And really, you know, I guess when a lot of people go to the store and they look at pasta, they might not realize the technical aspects of all that goes into it, and the engineering and the design, and and the processing to make sure, you know, when it gets to you, that it's, you know, not broken, and it's part, you know, looks good and it's done right. And you saw the machine, it's a pretty complex machine. Actually, once it comes off the extruder and goes into a dryer, the science behind the drying piece is very, very specific. And, you know, we wrestle with that all the time, and the technology and the automation and the control systems that go along with drying process. So it's not so straightforward as you may think. Another company just mentioned real quick is Claremont. They were another machinery making company. We actually shared a building with them at one time, but they made a lot of noodle machinery. I know Zurga has some of their equipment still to this day. This company went out of business in the mid-80s, and some of that machinery is still out there making noodles. And so they're a great company. The son-in-law of, the nephew of John Amato, who ran the company for many, many years, is one of the guys at Dairy Maid Ravioli. I don't know if Dairy Maid's near any of you guys, but I'm sorry?
It's in Gravesend.
Yeah, so great. Yeah, so they're Dairy Maid Ravioli in Brooklyn. Now we'll talk a little bit about some of the other companies. These companies came on the scene a little bit later, and this one was the one that Diane, my mom, her family was involved with. This was Gaspar Santoro, who was my great grandfather. So I actually, my mother and father were both in the business, so I'm a product from both sides of it. Maker of equipment and also maker of the pasta, so I got it on both sides. But this was my great grandfather's company, and Giulietta was the brand. And I remember my grandma saying that he was father was a hopeless romantic, and named it after, loved the story of Romeo and Juliet. So that's how the name Giulietta came about. And I guess there was a rumor at one time that he said it was, the design was really after my aunt, except my aunt didn't have blonde hair, so it couldn't have been my aunt. But anyway, that's Giulietta. And they were eventually, that brand was eventually bought out by Ronzoni. And they were one of the only ones that made fusilli.
It was specialties.
They made a lot of specialties, and so they had very specialized equipment.
Margarita.
They had a very, the fusilli is very difficult to make, you know, the long spiral. It droops if you don't do it right. So this is Santoro. So Paul Zawaro and Gaspar Santoro were the partners in Refine. After business together for 30 years, they broke apart, and it had to do with the succession issues. And Gaspar Santoro formed G. Santoro Macaroni, which is on Cook Street. And that's my grandmother on the box of the Santoro Macaroni. And that's my uncle. You can kind of see him in the picture there. Peptone.
He's a question. Santoro was the brand name?
It was a brand name, and also became a company.
But Refine manufactured it?
In the beginning, that was a brand. So they had a brand that Refine manufactured. Then he broke off the Santoro and actually started a separate company.
We still have the records.
I'm going to email you.
Do you?
The die cards.
I want to see it. I'd love to see it. Yeah.
We still have the records.
So, the Refine building, by the way, that got leveled when they built the BQE. So it's totally gone. There's what?
There was Refine had a plant
on Irving, okay.
Avenue too. I delivered stuff there.
A couple other brands from the area. You know, it was very regional. You know, brands were, there were a lot of family brands, a lot of small manufacturers, maybe kind of similar to craft beers of today. Mm-hmm. So you had a lot of, you know, very specific companies throughout Brooklyn. They're, you know, smaller, but they were making their own brands. There was quite a few of them. And there's a few more. There's many more than just this. But those are the ones I had labels for. And as a special note, I want to mention Ronzoni. They were not in Brooklyn, but they were close by. They were in Long Island City. Of course, you all are familiar with Ronzoni, I'm sure, from the supermarket. And they grew to be one of the biggest, and they still are today, one of the big brands in the area. So they're a very close neighbor to Brooklyn. What happened you know, to the companies, why are most, you know, why aren't there a lot of pasta companies like there once were? Well, as the industry grew, it became harder to get real estate here in Brooklyn. So a lot of them decided, instead of trying to grow in this place where it's pretty cramped, we're going to go to some of the suburbs. So they started moving some of the factories out of Brooklyn. And also, you know, pasta making is very logistical. So you have to bring in a lot of flour to make, you know, if you're starting to make a lot of quantity, you have to bring in a lot of flour. That's all got to be either trucked in, which is not so easy to do around here, or it has to come in by railroad. Most of the modern state-of-the-art plants now have, it's just brought in through railroad cars. So it was difficult to do that, to get real estate next to it. Of course, everybody in Brooklyn who's in the industry would want something near the railroad. So in particular, it was difficult to do. So they started moving out. This, of course, Zurga is right on the railroad in Fairlawn, New Jersey. I think it was in the 50s you guys moved out of Brooklyn?
51 or 2,
they moved out of Brooklyn, and they started up in Fairlawn, New Jersey. And then what happened was in the 80s, a lot of these, they were all family-owned companies. So these family-owned companies didn't have succession plans. They could, you know, they wanted to get out of the business. So they basically sold to conglomerates, sold their brands to these conglomerates. And then in the 90s, a lot of these old factories that were in existence, that were smaller scale, started closing up. And these mega factories would come online. And these mega factories, which are co-located right next to the Durham area, which is pasta made of Durham flour, is up, Durham wheat, is up in the Dakotas and in those areas. So a lot of the newer plants were made closer to the flour or to the semolina. And a lot of the older factories went offline. So today, though, there's been a resurgence of the artisan pasta. That's what we've seen. Quite a few people are really, these are chefs. We have one in the room, or a company in a room that's doing that as we speak, Salvellini. They're chefs who take great pride in making very high-end quality pasta. They're utilizing specialized wheat, nutritionals, any, you know, organic, gluten-free, all these different types of pastas, playing around with the ingredients and doing all kinds of innovative stuff. That's where we see a lot of the new stuff coming online, and you know, really having a lot of care. They're not making large quantities. They're really focused on the quality, and so we see a lot of that today in the industry, at least the growth in that area. And I can't, you know, I have to get Elvis in there. I'm a big fan. You know, his favorite was macaroni salad. But interesting is Sophia Loren was a macaroni queen in her early days of stardom. And this is a picture of her as the macaroni queen. And she said, I quote, "Everything you see I owe to spaghetti." So that really is her quote. So I put it up there, and I agree with that. That's the presentation. How am I doing on time? So I hope we have a couple of minutes for questions.
Was macaroni originally an Italian word that was used for an English dandy, or where did the word? It sounds like an Italian word. Yeah. It doesn't sound like an English term.
The fancy fashions that were popular in England with the kind of man about town set were designed by Italian designers who came up with this. A lot of flourishes and ruffles and fancy stuff.
So somebody who wore that was a macaroni.
Yeah, and that the English kind of named them macaroni because they eat a pasta.
Now, when I was a kid, you know, in the 40s and early 50s in Brooklyn, we would say we were having macaroni, but we also said, you know, pasta fazzole, and my father ate gigitas and pasta when he was a kid. So we were using both words. So which?
That's a good question. So basically, everything was called macaroni until like the 80s. Then it became, the general term became pasta. But you're exactly right. I mean, for many, many years.
Was pasta the Italian word?
That was just the way it was called. It was called macaroni, and that was a general term for everything.
Word.
So pasta was came out later, probably in the 80s, that really covered the whole gamut of all the different types of pasta. And just from the U.S. point of view too, there is FDA, Food and Drug Administration guidelines, standards of, it's called standards of identity. So if you say you're making a shape nowadays, there is, you know, there are some specifics. And these guys who make the dyes, Maldari makes the dyes, you know, they deal in such fine tolerances of machining. As was mentioned earlier, you know, there's an art to this. And, you know, they machine in thousandths of an inch. So the shapes are defined in these standards of identity. To protect the consumer, really.
Please. When you were showing the early photographs of the the machines that would spread the spaghetti and so forth, at that time, were there all the other shapes too?
There were more shapes years ago than there are today.
But I mean, the machines were just like somehow dealing with the spaghetti issue. In Italy, were there, I mean, I know in Italy there were the like softer ones like gnocchi and you know, things that were like hand rolled. But in Italy, were there lots of different shapes?
Yeah,
so in Italy, shapes are very regionalized. Even like a town could have a shape that its favorite
even
shape.
Dishes were made with specific shapes.
Yeah.
Pasta bisel or, you know.
My non-Italian ex thought it was hysterical that we would stand there and try to decide, okay, what do we have today? So is it going to be
but you call it sauce or gravy, and we put on top.
We call it sauce in my family.
Sauce.
Okay, sure, Mr. Gallo, right? That's my mother's maiden name.
Do they make any pasta that's not extruded?
Yes.
Sheeted.
Yeah.
Handmade.
Excellent question.
Rolled. There's machines that make specific
ravioli.
Pasta prezzi, mm-hmm. rolled and all
lasagna is rolled.
No, lasagna is extruded or it could be sheeted.
I want to say something about lasagna real quick because I forgot to say this.
It's an American shape.
Ripple. So lasagna is a rippled edge that you see in the store today. Was actually invented by Stefano La Rosa, same guy who came with the packaging. And the reason he invented it that way was for the packaging, for the cooking, so that it would not stick together. But this is that's an American innovation. You go to Italy today, you will not, I don't think they have.
It's flat.
You don't see, and also it made it, since the packaging, it made it easier to package when it was rippled edge. So that's a innovation, right? Here, rippled edge lasagna is an innovation from Brooklyn.
But raffetta pasta in Manhattan, they make their own pasta and their lasagna has no edges.
Yeah, so
You could make, you know, manicotti out of it.
And now they have the pre-cooked one that you don't even have to boil
And one more story about, I'll tell you about the tortellini because I love Italians when they come to naming pasta. So, you know, you had a pastaio and he was just a legend. You know, he was telling great, making ravioli by hand and. Across the street from this ravioli maker was a beautiful woman with a midriff shirt. And, you know, he's watching, making ravioli every day, and he said, I'm going to imitate her belly button. So he took the ravioli, pinched it and rolled it, and made it to imitate her belly button, and that's the tortellini. Leah.
There's so many, like, gluten-free people now, and people think that pasta is not good for you. I don't know. I just
want to
hear a little bit about like the nutritional part of pasta.
Okay, so good question. But what I'll say about pasta is this: it's really diet to me is, and you're as a physician, you know a lot about this too. But it's about the glycemic index and keeping it stabilized. And when you have spikes, is when your body starts storing fat and all that. Pasta, actually, when it's extruded, is actually compacted. It goes through the dye and gets compacted. So when it digests slower because it's been compacted as compared to other gluten products like bread. That's for one thing. Also, it's the durum, which is a wheat based on grass, basically. So it's because of that, it's harder to digest also. And so there's some components to that make it less of an impact as other starchy foods. But, you know, it's all about the, obviously the Mediterranean diet is highly regarded as being a very healthy diet, and it has to do with the vegetables and, you know, the way you serve it and the way you prepare it and all the fresh pieces that go along with it, and, you know, just eating in moderation. So, you know, it's, I think it's blown out of proportion. I think there's some bad science out there that's saying that pasta is the evil of all things, but obviously it's definitely, that's just not true. It's been debunked many, many times by a lot of studies. So,
yeah, but, I mean, if you're allergic to gluten, you're allergic to gluten. So at that point,
That's what you're talking about, a difference. Yeah. So for, if you're talking about gluten allergy, I mean, that part of it, is that what you're saying specifically?
No, I say a lot of people are.
Yeah. So gluten, there is some. Right now, there's been a lot of talk about celiac disease, and, you know, people are very sick from gluten. So there is ways now that they're making pasta.
They're making a lot of gluten-free pasta
without gluten.
The same way that they make regular pasta.
But the thing is, pasta is the starches and that hold it together, you know. So you have to have some way to gelatinize whatever it is that you're making them so that the pasta stays together. And so there's different ways to do that, gums and all kinds of different things. Okay. And there's some real good innovations, honestly, in that whole field of gluten-free pasta making. You'll see, many, many products out there. A lot of people playing around with it.
Beans.
But, does it hold out? Does it give you that al dente taste you're looking for? When it cooks, does it turn to mush? You know, all those problems are still, the manufacturers are working through a lot of those issues today.
Going along with that, the whole wheat pastas and white grain pastas, does that affect your machines, or does it, no?
No. We,
it's color?
Well, our machines are really robust.
Yeah, sorry. Their machines are robust, but certain more granular dough will wear out dyes faster.
Which is a good thing.
Yeah.
Yes, I was interested in, you were talking about how the machines were innovated here in Brooklyn. Does that mean that Italy was actually behind in the manufacturing trajectory?
Don't get me wrong. Italians are great engineers, and they had a lot of good innovations. I'm simply pointing out, though, that the Americans also had, they contributed. I mean, there's a lot of stereotypes about, you know, pasta being with Italy, but there's just a lot of innovations too, and that's what I was highlighting in this. The Italians are great machinery designers. You know, they do a lot of great work with that. So I, you know, not saying that at all. But this case of the machine that I showed you, the spreader, yes, because in actuality, that machine, which got patented in the United States, was one of the few machines, if you can believe it, the Italians actually bought from the United States. I mean, so that machine was a very unique contribution to the industry, and so much so that my grandfather actually sold them to Italy, which is, you know, can you imagine an American machine in
that doesn't happen.
So on the heels of that, just as far as the machines are concerned, you were talking about some manufacturers that were very small in Brooklyn. Like, how did they handle the purchasing of the machines look like? Huge and expensive?
Yeah, they we had different size ones, and if they didn't buy these big machines, they could still make it by hand if it's small enough, you know, quantities. They still have the option of, this is following the Industrial Revolution. You know, these machines are following the same kind of trends as the rest of the industry. If you see that these more industrial machines coming online, it's really during the time period America went through the Industrial Revolution. So there's a lot of, you know, cool things that, like, if you look at this, I just love this picture. I mean, this is a great picture. But if you look on the top, it's probably hard to see from where you're at, but the whole factory was driven off of one generator, that one motor, and then there's a belt system, you know, a pulley system on the top, and then they would actually throw the belts onto whatever machine they're going to run that day, and they ran it, and then they would throw the belt on another machine if they were running that. So you had the three machines I was talking about. They would throw all off of one motor. So, you know, it's really cool innovations. They call these bobbit bearings. And I remember my father telling me, you know, his father would tell him, you got to oil the bearings on the top. And he would, you know, the Dickens in him, he would, you know, just drop the oil on the ground. Because you could tell the ground, when my grandfather wasn't looking, he would squirt the ground with some oil. And everybody would think that the machine was, the bobbit bearings were being oiled. But in actuality, it was just oiling the ground.
Are these dyes patented? Are these shapes patented?
Years ago they did. Prince Macaroni worked with us to do, if you see the lasagnas with the corrugations in the
right.
middle, they patented those. CPC, there's a shape over there called the radiator. That was patented by the shape. Years ago they did, but they haven't, years and years they haven't done that, you know.
You have certain shapes that are licensed now, though, like
yeah, well, shapes, like Disney like shapes, you have to get the licensing agreement. But actually, the designing of unique shapes is an old process which doesn't happen much anymore. Companies, if they could make one product, elbows, and run it 24 hours a day and sell it and make money, they would.
And one other comment too about the innovation. There's a lot of really good innovation too on the controls, which I didn't cover at all in here. But if you ask, like, what are we doing today? A lot of it has to do with the controls of, especially the dryers, and the computerized. You know, because it's very, it has to be very monitored very carefully. It has to be controlled very closely. And that control system using factory automation, is some great innovations there. To improve, make it more energy efficient, make it more green, make it less waste, more consistent. There's just a lot of really good innovation there that you may not really realize the results of that, but these factories are because of the savings they're getting and the less waste, the less problems they're having. You've been a great audience. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.